Well, good evening, everyone, and the peace of the Lord be with you. It is a joy to be with you tonight, especially tonight, this night when you are commissioning your global servants through World Outreach. That is such an honor for me to be here. I've recently traveled to Southeast Asia with Gabriel, and just a funny little thing happened as we were traveling. I'd really never been in Southeast Asia. And traveling with Gabriel was a real treat because everywhere we went, first we stopped in the Philippines, and of course all the Filipinos look at Gabriel and they start speaking the local language. They think he's one of them, which he is actually. He's of Filipino parentage. So I thought, okay, that's all right. And then we meet some people from Cambodia. Would you believe the same thing happens? They start speaking to him in the local language, or they ask him, are you from Cambodia? You look like us. And then Vietnamese, the same thing. And then people from Nepal, the same thing. So, Gabriel, I've decided you're the ticket, man. I'm going to travel with you. It's my way in these places. Well, the first thing I want to say is a sincere thank you on behalf of my colleagues in World Outreach. We know that we cannot do what we do without you. In fact, we would not exist without you. Your support of World Outreach materially and spiritually is our lifeline. And you are our DNA, right? Our spiritual DNA is from you. We can't take more than you are to the nations of the world. So please hear my sincere thanks. Now, you're back here tonight after a day full. You're energetic in your worship, and you're eager to hear the word of God. So let's do that. Let's go to Acts, the 8th chapter. You will know this is the story of Philip and his evangelistic ministry. We're going to read this from the New Testament and then an Old Testament passage, which we will turn to in just a moment. This is the word of our Lord, Acts 8, beginning with the first 8 verses. And there arose on that day a great persecution against the church in Jerusalem, and they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Devout men buried Stephen and made great lamentation over him. But Saul was ravaging the church and entering house after house. He dragged off men and women and committed them to prison. Now those who were scattered went about preaching the word. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ. And the crowds with one accord paid attention to what was being said by Philip. When they heard him and saw the signs that he did, for unclean spirits crying out with a loud voice came out of many who had them, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. So there was much joy in that city. Now down to verse 26 of the same chapter. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Rise and go toward the south to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a desert place." And he rose and went. And there was an Ethiopian, a eunuch, a court official of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of all her treasure. He had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning seated in his chariot. And he was reading the prophet Isaiah. And the Spirit said to Philip, "Go over and join this chariot." So Philip ran to him and heard him reading Isaiah the prophet and asked, "Do you understand what you are reading?" And he said, "How can I, unless someone guides me?" And he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. Now the passage of the scripture that he was reading was this: "Like a sheep he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he opens not his mouth. In his humiliation justice was denied him, and who can describe his generation? For his life is taken away from the earth." And the eunuch said to Philip, "About whom, I ask you, does the prophet say this? About himself or about someone else?" Then Philip opened his mouth, and beginning with this scripture, he told him the good news about Jesus. And as they were going along the road and they came to some water, the eunuch said, "See, here is water. What prevents me from being baptized?" And he commanded the chariot to stop, and they both went down into the water, Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. Now, if you can just keep your place there and flip back to the book of Isaiah, going to read only one verse from Isaiah. It's Isaiah 49, 6. And here I think we find the headwaters of this spiritual energy that we've just read about in the book of Acts. Isaiah 49, verse 6, he says, "It is too light a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and bring back the preserved of Israel. I will make you as a light for the nations, that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth." Now, Holy Spirit, attend here. Move from us the distractions and the blinders. Take away the blocks, Father. Let us hear the word of God as you've given it to us in all its power and all its truth. We trust you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Parents give to their children. And good parents give of themselves to their children. They deprive themselves so that they can give to their kids. And I think we can all identify with that sentiment, can't we? Either you've been a parent or you've had a parent. Even those of you that have had maybe a less than ideal parent, you know the truth of this because you missed it in your life, right? Now, I think that sentiment gets us close to what we've just read in the book of Isaiah. Because it is Yahweh speaking in this passage. It is the God of Israel, and he's speaking through the prophet to the suffering servant. And we know from Matthew chapter 12 and other places in the New Testament that the suffering servant is fulfilled in our Lord Jesus Christ. So what we have here is a dialogue, a conversation among the persons of the Trinity. And Yahweh says of his Son, "It is too light a thing. It's not enough. It's not weighty enough. It's not significant enough. It's too small for my Son." And what is this thing that's too small? Well, it's right there in the verse, isn't it? It was to bring back the lost ones of Jacob and to restore the lost ones of Judah. Now, think about that for a moment, because you're all Bible people, right? You know that was the burning question that was on the heart of Isaiah the prophet. And it was the burning question that was on the people of Israel. It was all that occupied them. But what about us? What about our nation? What about our people? What about the law? What about the temple? We're living in the shadow of this great power that's about to exile us. What's going to happen? And the prophet says, "Too small a thing. Too small a thing." Makes us think about the questions we have, doesn't it? About our land, our people, our church. What's going on? Is our nation going to hell in a handbasket? Is the church in decline? What's going on, Lord? And to those questions, Yahweh says, "Too small a thing. Too small a thing." And what is enough? What is it that becomes the thing that is enough for his Son? Well, again, it's right there in the passage, isn't it? "I will make you a light to the nations, that my salvation may reach to the ends of the earth." Brothers and sisters, and especially to these who are gathered here, are going to be commissioned tonight, let me say that there are a lot of things that motivate us to go in mission, right? For some of us, it's the love of adventure. Can you believe that? Or it's the needs of the people that we're going to. Or it's the desperate situation they're in because of false ideologies and false beliefs. But I can attest to you that every one of those motivations, the flame of them will flicker and die until we are connected to this one sole motivation. It is the love of God the Father for his Son and his decree that he will be a light to the nations to cause the salvation of Yahweh to go to all the nations. Can I say it another way? before God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, he so loved his only son that he gave him the world. You see, brothers and sisters, we're not talking about a peripheral program of the church. We're talking about the passion of God, his Trinitarian, other-preferring, self-giving love that has determined that his beloved Son will be the object of adoration and worship among all the nations and peoples of the earth. Are you with me? Now, when we get that motivation right, then we can see what's happening in Acts 8. Because this passion of the Father, it runs through the pages of Scripture until in some places it begins to flow in great leaps and bounds and cascades. And that's what's happening in the book of Acts. So we're going to look at it just through two headings, rather briefly. I know you know the story well, so I'll try to avoid summarizing the story. But the two headings are an insider who moves out, and then an outsider who moves in. So the insider who moves out in Acts chapter 8 is Philip. And it's Philip the deacon, not Philip the apostle. And that's important for us to note. You will recall that the deacons were chosen to mend a division in the early church. It was a very local church problem, wasn't it? Some widows were complaining that they were being overlooked in the food distribution, and the apostles didn't want to leave the teaching of the word in prayer. So they said, we're going to choose seven men full of the Holy Spirit and men of integrity, and they're going to serve the tables for us. And so that division was healed. And man, it was a glorious healing. The status quo was restored, but not just sort of a low status quo. In fact, after that event, Acts 6 says that the disciples were multiplying in Jerusalem. They were multiplying and many priests were coming to the faith. I doubt there's a person in here, a pastor, a minister, an elder, who would not want to be a part of that church. It was an amazing church, wasn't it? We know that. So the status quo was restored, right? But the status quo is about to be disrupted because Saul of Tarsus is on the prowl, isn't he? And Stephen has been stoned, dragged out of the streets of Jerusalem and killed by stoning. Now, I don't know if you can even imagine how your church would react to such a situation. But what the early church did, what the Jerusalem believers did, was they scattered. And Luke, the author of Acts, says that they scattered preaching the gospel. Now, I want you to note here that here for the first time, for the first time, the church that has gathered is now going, right? The church that has settled is now sent. And it's less than ideal circumstances that bring that about. And Philip becomes the case in point. As he goes up to Samaria, he preaches the gospel. Great signs and wonders are done. There is great joy in that city. So the fruit of this preaching of the gospel is enormous. It's enormous. Now that's the story. But I want us to just pause there for a moment and think about what this might mean for us. And the first thing I'd like to say is the disruption of the status quo. It's actually divinely orchestrated here, isn't it? Because Jesus had a plan, right? He had a plan that the gospel was to go to Jerusalem, to Judea, to Samaria, and then to the uttermost parts of the earth. But the disciples are still in Jerusalem. And so something terrible happens. And Samaria receives the gospel. Samaria receives the gospel. Now, what about you? I'm guessing that the status quo has been disrupted for you, hasn't it? We've spoken about the decline of the American church. Attendance, or those who identify as Christians, have decreased in my lifetime in this country from 90% to 60%. We sort of know We're living in that world, aren't we, of this post-Christian world. Church attendance has gone down 25%. And some of you have been through the pandemic, or you've been through the most polarizing political and social circumstances of any of recent memory. Haven't you? And you're feeling gut punched. And maybe you want to turn and run. Or maybe you want to go take a long vacation in the Caribbean. But I think what the word here reminds us is that the disruption of the status quo is for a purpose. And it's to recalibrate our vision on what God is doing in the nations, the passion of the Father for the Son, that the gospel is to spread. So our disruption of the status quo is not beyond his control. And it's not intended for us to hunker down in our Jerusalem. It's intended for us to spread, preaching the gospel. And then I want to use another word that might be surprising to some of you, but I'm going to suggest that this chapter is the beginning of what I will call the apostolate. The apostolate. Now, I could have easily said this is the beginning of mission, and that would have gone over really easily with all of you. I suspect that my using the word apostolate might raise a few eyebrows among you. So do me the kindness to realize I'm not talking about the 12 apostles, the authority to write scripture, and to have seen the resurrected Lord. Philip is not one of the 12, is he? And yet he scattered preaching the gospel, and later he sent down to the Ethiopian, to a desert road. This is the beginning of the church on the move. And if you follow the narrative of the book of Acts, I'm not saying anything that you don't know, it is from this point that every chapter will talk about the gospel on the move through the people of God. Now, I want us to get that in our minds. There is the church settled, and there is the church sent. There is the church gathered, and there is the church going. And there have to be both. It's biblical. We need you, we who go, and you need us. See that passage up there, Ephesians 4:12? It says, so that the saints will be equipped, right? For the equipping of the saints. But we're good Bible people, and we know that before that comes Ephesians 4:11. And you remember it, don't you? It says, the resurrected Christ gave his gifts to the church. You remember them? Apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, or shepherds, and teachers. Now, we as Presbyterians, we do really good with the last part. We're all teaching elders, ruling elders. We're all shepherds and teachers, right? That's why we're here. I want to suggest to you that for the saints to be equipped, we also need the first three, the apostles and the prophets and the evangelist. So every church would need a healthy pastorate. Isn't that true? Wouldn't it stand to reason that every church needs a healthy apostolate? Do we give as much time and energy and care to the church going as we do to the church gathered? To the church sent as to the church settled? If we're here to equip the saints for the work of ministry, we must. We must. So that's the insider who moves out. But I want to talk for just a moment about this outsider moving in. And this is the Ethiopian. This is the eunuch. Now, in our day, we're familiar with sexual preferences, right? We know this whole LGBTQ abbreviation. We know a lot about it. We read a lot about it. But I'm guessing that because there's no E in that string of letters, most of you have not dealt with a eunuch. And I haven't. Most people in this day, the day that Luke is writing, knew about eunuchs. They understood. Jesus knew about eunuchs as well. Now, one thing that's important to understand about the eunuch is the eunuch usually came from the slave or the servant classes. And this eunuch most likely was not born a eunuch. Jesus mentions those who are born eunuchs, right? This man was probably made a eunuch. And there's a reason for that. It's because as those servants and slaves in their master's household became very competent, very useful to their masters, there was always the risk that a crafty servant would pull off some of the riches and pass them on to his own children, to his own descendants. So in order to ensure that the wealth of the slave owner stayed within the family circle of the slave owner, those competent, powerful people were deprived of the right to reproduce. They were made eunuchs. Now, Luke says four times in the passage, he mentions that he's a eunuch. I think he wants us to take notice of that. Now, some of you say, I can't believe that guy's up there talking about, you know, male reproductive organs. But it's important because dirty things like this are still happening in our world. Right? So Luke writes it for a reason. He wants us to understand. And I know you've heard that this is the powerful Ethiopian eunuch, the minister of finance. But I'm suggesting to you, he's a powerful, disempowered man. A powerful, but disempowered man. And not only that, but he had traveled all the way to Jerusalem, and he was not allowed in the temple. Check it out, Deuteronomy 23:1. Nobody with his particular deformity was allowed to worship God with God's holy people. Think about it. Now that sets us up to read this Isaiah passage in a different way. Will you listen to it again and think about the experience of a slave who's been made a eunuch against his will? Listen, like a sheep, he was led to the slaughter. If I'm not mistaken, that's a cutting metaphor. And like a lamb before its shearers is silent, so he opens not his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. And who can describe his generation, literally his offspring? Who can describe his offspring? For his life is taken away from the earth. So brothers, this is Isaiah 53. It's that beautiful in my place gospel, right? That he was bruised for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment for our peace fell upon him, and by his stripes we are healed, right? That's the beautiful in my place gospel of Isaiah. But this is another aspect of that same true, beautiful gospel. It is the innocent victim, the one who absorbs the evil of the world into himself, the oppression, the abuse, the injustice, takes it to the grave, and I'm certain that Philip would have expounded this beautifully, takes it to the grave and then rises victorious, welcoming all the oppressed into his embrace as his sons and daughters. So I want to suggest that this passage says two things to us. One, it talks about the beauty of the gospel. I don't know about you, but in our world, the gospel is much maligned. It becomes a source of division for many people. But this passage reminds us that for those who are under the tsunami of social and collective sin in our world, for those who are oppressed and have no voice, for those who have no dignity, for those who are displaced, for those who are abused, the gospel is great hope. I could tell you the story of a Kurdish young woman who, when she heard that she had a father who loved her and that Jesus was her older brother, And she realized that her children, who had no physical father, now had a heavenly father. I want to tell you that no religious heritage and no cultural barrier could keep her away from the gospel. The gospel was her great joy. It was the precious pearl. It was the field in which she hid the treasure. She would sell everything for it. When I was traveling with Gabriel in South Asia, we heard the stories of these Vietnamese. They were under a communist regime, and they had received radios, shortwave radios, as a tool of propaganda by the communist government. But they didn't listen to the communist propaganda, which was in the national language. They tuned in the Far East Broadcasting Company that was broadcasting in their own language. And one by one, these families began to take down their family shrines, stop their sacrificing to their ancestors, stop paying the shamans for their services, and they began to call themselves Christians before anyone had ever shown up, any gospel messenger had ever shown up in their country. Brothers and sisters, I want to tell you that this gospel of the kingdom is growing like wildfire in our world. It is still good news if we have the courage to proclaim it. But I want to say, and you know this, don't you? I'm not offending people here. It's not the gospel of the conservative right or the liberal left or of American consumerism. We've got to be shed of those gospels. We've got to be stripped of those gospels, so that we offer the real gospel, the gospel that Philip expounded to this Ethiopian. It was great news to him, so great that he said, here's water. What prevents me from being baptized? Isn't that amazing? That's a wonderful story. So the first point I want to just highlight here is the beauty of the gospel. It's good news. But the second point is the reality of the unreached. The reality of the unreached. Now, Philip ran up to him and he said, do you understand what you are reading? The Ethiopian must have been a very educated man because he was reading the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Old Testament. And Philip, being a Greek speaker, understood exactly what he was reading. So he had a linguistic qualification to take the gospel to him. But furthermore, Philip had sat under the apostles' teaching. You remember that from the time Jesus rose from the dead and appeared to the apostles, he was opening their minds to understand the scriptures in a new way. So Philip was a discipled believer, equipped, ready to share this Christ-centered interpretation of the Old Testament with the Ethiopian eunuch. And he did. He expounded it to him. Now, you might say, but Mike, this Ethiopian, he's not an unreached person. He's not an unreached person. But if you had been a Jew in Jerusalem in that day, do you realize that the kingdom of the Ethiopians would have been the far reaches of the world? I'm sure Luke is telling it with a wry smile because he's saying, didn't Jesus say it would go to Samaria and then to the ends of the earth? Here it is, right in chapter 8. We could end Acts 8 right here and we would have Acts 1:8 fulfilled, because it's going to the ends of the world. And you might say to me, but Mike, and I hear this in the churches, right? Mike, it's the internet, you know, the gospel covers the world now. Come on, buddy. And after all, it's immigration. You know, the unreached are coming to us. And praise God they are. I hope you're welcoming them. I know some of you are. Or here's another one I hear a lot. The nationals are doing it. You know, we don't need to send American missionaries anymore. We're just, our missions are just glorified colonialism. We need to pull back, let the nationals do their work. Well, brothers and sisters, here is this Ethiopian eunuch. He's reading the most powerful gospel tract you can imagine, isn't he? He's just been in Jerusalem, the hotbed of Holy Spirit activity. And he's riding back in his chariot and he's reading from Isaiah. And Philip asks him, do you understand what you're reading? And he says, how can I? How can I unless someone guides me? I have just a moment. Let me share with you a story. I'm from the South, but when we moved back from overseas, we moved up to the Pacific Northwest, and some of my friends were saying to me, you're moving to unreached people up there. Sorry, apologies to all you Pacific Northwesterners. And imagine my delight, my shock, my surprise, but my delight when I go to a cafe and I'm typing away on my laptop and just over beside me, I can't concentrate very well because this couple's praying together. Or over to my left, there's four or five engaged in Bible study. When we talk about unreached people, we're not talking about places where there are relatively fewer believers. Do you get that? I was in a taxi in Sana'a, Yemen, high elevations of the southern Arabian Peninsula. And I squeezed into the back of this Peugeot taxi with robed men with beards all around me with daggers in their belts. Have you ever seen the daggers of Yemen? And we struck up, you know, just a friendly chit-chat. But when they realized that I spoke Arabic, the oldest guy in the car, who was in the seat ahead of me, turned around and he said, Ya ajnabi, ad'uka ila al-Islam. He said, foreigner, I invite you to Islam. And every person in that car, with the exception of yours truly, was nodding their head and saying, Ameen. Brothers and sisters, there are places in this world where the odds of someone meeting a gospel witness who can explain to them the gospel, who can guide them to understand the gospel, are infinitesimally small. Or I remember, I was in North Africa. I remember a train ride from Fez to Casablanca, and the villages are built right up against the train tracks. And I remember seeing the little kids running with bare feet and bare bottoms, kicking their balls through the dirt streets, and the women spreading out their grain to dry. And I knew, because I knew that that country was 99.9% Muslim, I knew if they stayed there and lived the entirety of their lives there, the odds of them hearing the gospel from a competent witness in their language, in terms they could understand, were almost nil. Brothers and sisters, this is the state of about 3 billion people in our world. Now, I know because the nationals are doing it more, they are, because the internet is available, and because of immigration, our world is changing. But I want to say to us as the EPC, it is not time for us to stop sending. It is time for us to ask the questions of how we send. But it is not time to stop. Will you pray with me? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root. And the lamb who was slain to ransom the slave. We say, Amen, Lord Jesus. You are worthy. And it is our great joy and privilege to follow you as you precede us into the nations of this world to reap the harvest that is yours. In joy we go, and in joy we send these tonight. Amen.